leading role in converting others to Christ. Using the health message as God's preferred method of engagement, the mission of the H3 Project is to serve communities with resources, programs, and seminars that will restore health, offer hope, and facilitate healing. In doing so, the goal is for the people we serve to attain a passion and gain a deeper understanding of health that will lead to personal responsibility and ownership of their mental, physical, and spiritual well-being. To start the new year, today's health spotlight will focus on three health facts for your awareness. Fact one, U.S. life expectancy at birth dropped from 77 years in 2020 to 76.4 years in 2021, marking the second consecutive year of decline and the shortest expectancy since 1996, largely due to COVID-19, according to CDC's National Center of Health Statistics. Overall mortality rates for all ages groups, except infants younger than 1 year, the data show that heart disease, cancer, and COVID-19 were the top three causes of death in the United States, accounting for about 50% of all deaths last year. Fact two, a recently published 2021 report from the World Health Organization indicates that nearly 500 million people worldwide will experience serious illness by the year 2020-30 as a result of low physical activity, which likely would translate to $300 billion of care costs if the government and, most important, individuals do not take action. This report, based on a study of physical activity levels in 174 nations, says that the illness would be largely preventable if individuals would just exercise every day. January is National Glaucoma Awareness Month. This is an important time to spread the word about this sight-stealing disease. More than 3 million people in the United States have glaucoma, and over 60 million people worldwide have glaucoma. The National Eye Institute projects this number will reach 4.2 million by 2030, a 58% increase. Glaucoma is called the sneak thief of sight, since there are no symptoms, and once vision is lost, it's permanent. As much as 40% of vision can be lost without a person even noticing it. So if you have had glaucoma, you may not notice anything until significant vision is lost. Glaucoma is the leading cause of irreversible blindness. The World Health Organization estimates that 4.5 million people worldwide are blind due to glaucoma. Are you at risk for glaucoma? Those at higher risk include people of African, Asian, and Hispanic descent. Glaucoma is 6 to 8 times more common in African Americans than Caucasians. Other high-risk groups include people over 60, family members of those already diagnosed, diabetics, and people who are severely nearsighted. Also, siblings of persons diagnosed with glaucoma have a significant increase in getting glaucoma. If you are at risk, the best way to protect your sight from glaucoma is early detection by annual screening and getting a comprehensive eye exam. So let's make people aware of glaucoma Talk to friends and family about glaucoma. If you have glaucoma, don't keep it a secret. Let your family members know. My testimony is, on my deceased grandfather family line, my grandfather and all of his siblings got glaucoma. My mother and all of her siblings got glaucoma. We're talking about 9 family members here. Of these 9 family members, 5 lost eyesight due to late detection and non-compliance to treatment. Knowing this, I have been receiving comprehensive eye exams for glaucoma since the age of 25. At the age of 63, I got diagnosed with angle closure glaucoma, got treated promptly, and as of today, have not lost any eyesight due to glaucoma. My 89-year-old mom has been diagnosed with glaucoma for the last 30 years and is very compliant with her treatment and have not lost eyesight due to glaucoma. Yes, to God be the glory. I will end by imploring each of you to begin this new year by taking control and ownership of your health. Take the necessary precautions to prevent COVID. Complete the necessary health screens for heart disease, cancer, and glaucoma, and start or continue your daily exercise program. In addition, learn about and follow God's 10 laws of health, which are trust more, stress less, get rest and sleep, enjoy sunshine, exercise, drink water, live temperately, invest time in others, get fresh air, and educate yourself. Thank you for your attention.
Good morning, Decatur. It is so good to see each and every one of your faces this morning. I'm so glad to be here. Welcome to 2023, a year we've never seen before. And so, I think about our calendar throughout the year. We have 365 days in the year, typically, And in that year, there are so many different celebrations. Last week, we got to celebrate. We had our church social. Wasn't that nice for those of you who went there? We had a good time. We had fun, food, and all that kind of stuff. I see your head shaking. And we had a good time. So there's other celebrations throughout the year as well. We celebrate holidays. We celebrate birthdays. And so many other things that our calendars are filled with. But, you know, there's one thing that I have to keep reminding myself of each year as I prepare to celebrate the new year, which I do, is to make sure, one more thing too, one thing that we do throughout the year is, at the new year, what do? We always make these resolutions. So like this year, January 1st, I'm going to change my diet. I'm going to pray more. I'm going to lose weight. And a lot of times we meet these goals and sometimes we don't. There's still challenges. But as I start each new year, I have to remind myself that while this is a new year for us here in this earth, in this country, or whatever it is, that this is also an opportunity for me to rededicate myself to God anew and say, Lord, I'm making a promise to you that this year with you is going to be better than last year with you. And I can't do it in my own power. I can only do it with your strength and your hope and your help, I mean. So I just want to encourage each of you to add God in your life each and every day, but as we start this new year, just recommit in your life that God, we're going to be better this year than we were last year. Amen? Do we have any first-time visitors visiting with us today? If you're here for the first time, we'd like to see who you are. Please stand, raise your hand. Amen, amen, amen. We have something we're going to put in your hands in a second. Glad to see you here. If you're able, come back and see us again sometime, okay? Love you guys. You take care. God bless, Pastor.
Good afternoon, Decatur. Would you please stand with me for our call to worship? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us and not we ourselves, but we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures for all generations. Now, if you will please join with me as we pray. Father above, we thank you so much for bringing us to this first Sabbath of the new year. We thank you for bringing us all together as church family, Lord. Whether we're in the sanctuary or whether we're online, Lord, we thank you for bringing us together to bless your name and to worship you today. We ask that you would bring your Holy Spirit with us as we give you the praise and the honor that you and you alone deserve. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, if you will turn with me in your hymnals to hymn number 27, we will sing our opening hymn. Rejoice, ye pure in heart.
Give thanks and sing. Anyone come to sing on today? Do we have a heart of thanksgiving on today? Do we come with a praise on our lips on today? God is worthy of all praise, honor, and glory. I feel it's a little heavy on the anointing. It's thick on this side. Can we outpraise the right side, y'all? God has been too good. Amen. We have breath in our bodies, and for that we bless him. Amen. On behalf of the pastoral staff, our senior pastor, Dr. Compton Ross, myself, your assistant pastor, Jamil Adams, we want to welcome you all to Decatur. We are so blessed and glad that you chose to worship with us on today. Can I get an amen on there? Thank you to our first and second time visitors and our frequent flyers. We are going to take this opportunity now to welcome up our family. We have a very special baby dedication on today. Can the church say amen? Have got what a way to start the new year, right? With another baby blessing. Well, how many did we have last year? Felt like 20. Somebody said a lot. It was a lot. God is good. So I invite all of our pastoral staff, our elders, all of our ministries that are here to support for the baby blessing, also the family as well, and the supporters, please join us here on stage. Let's give them a hand. Let's make them feel welcome. You know, that aisle is real long when you're walking by yourself. Let's make them feel welcome. Amen.
And little Caden. And we're so happy today to welcome them into the family of God and the Decatur Seventh-day Adventist Church family. We're just so delighted to have you all here today. And little Caden is their firstborn. And he is the first child that we're dedicating in 2023. Amen, amen. Amen. I do not believe in coincidences. I believe Tito and Yakini, that this is providential. I believe that we have a leader today in little Caden. I want to point you to Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5. As his parents, you've brought him here today, and I had the opportunity to visit with you guys and to just feel your excitement of God's blessings and your desire to really bring him up in the way that God would have you to. In Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5, God said through his prophet, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." And so first of all, God said, "I formed this little boy." He's not by chance, Yakini, Tito. God formed him, and he specially endowed him with certain qualities and gifts, and he gave him to you. And so first of all, I want to say to you all, treasure him. Treasure him. And that means just love on him. Spend time with him. God also said of his prophet, and as he said of Caden, "I've set him apart. I've set him apart." In other words, God made him with a purpose in mind. He's already put certain things in this little boy. He's put greatness in him. He's put talents and abilities in him so that he can fulfill his purpose on this earth. It is for you, Tito, and you, Kenny, to discover what those gifts are in him. He has mental gifts and physical gifts and social gifts that are very unique to him. And so the Bible says, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he's old, he would not depart from it. Treasure him for the gift that he is and train him for the purpose that God has called him to. Now, this is a big task, parents, but I want to say to you that God is on your side, and that each and every day as you spend time with God, you may ask Him for wisdom, and He will guide you in how to raise this little boy. Not only that, but you have a community, and we stand here with you all today. This is your community. This is your entire community here, and we're with you all to love on you and to encourage you in the way that God would have you to go. I'm going to call on Pastor Day to come right now, and we will pray over and give this little boy back to God.
All right, let's pray. Father in heaven, right now, in the name of Jesus, we ask for your Spirit to enter into this baby's soul. Father, we pray that your life will be within him as long as he may live. Lord, we ask that every place that he goes, people may see that he is a living vessel for you. Father, allow the parents to be an example so that everywhere that he may, any room that he is in with them, that he can be led by an example. Lord, right now we ask that you send your angels to continue to protect over him. Guard his heart and his mind from the things that the enemy may try to place in his path. Lord, guard his eyes from the things that are on tablets and TVs and cell phones, God. We ask for your continued direction as he begins to walk and walking, and God, that you may lead him even in his first steps. Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do in this family's life. Lord, we ask for your continued blessings. Double the portion in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
My family and I would like to invest in your diaper ministry. And provide a set of diapers and wipes here as you all have quite a time to go with some diapers. We thank God because it's a mortgage, right? And we were relieved when that thing was over with. So praise God.
Amen, 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 amen. We have some other members of the family, of the village here. Sister Melton?
You know, happy Sabbath, happy New Year. It is a blessing to be standing next to you. God bless you. Great and precious promises. And one of them is, as the pastor has said, train up a child in the way that he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. That's Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. God has chosen this family to dedicate little Caden to the Lord on the first Sabbath of the new year for a special purpose, for a new beginning. I present this gift to Caden from the Decatur Adventist Early Learning Center.
Amen, amen.
And we pray that Caden will be a part of the Decatur Adventist Early Learning Center, and the school will be a part of the training for the beginning of this year. And God bless you.
Amen, amen, amen. Sister Darlene Bliss, cradle roll.
Good morning. I'm usually here to greet you when you walk in the door with my excitement because I'm in the cradle roll department. But we had Sabbath school this morning over at the Crest Center. Amen.
Amen, amen.
And
amen,
it was a wonderful amen. Occasion. And we hope that you come and bring your baby on the third Sabbath of this month. We start at 10 o'clock with breakfast, and we're learning about the farm, and we're having such an exciting time. You know, in my mind, two things are very important in the church: baptism and the blessing of a baby. That's an open acknowledgement that you're giving your child to Christ. And as you see, we take it very seriously in Decatur, because we love children and we want you to feel a part of our family. No, I don't want you to come back and visit. I want to see you in Sabbath school every Sabbath. We do have Zoom on the second or fourth Sabbath, but we do look forward to seeing you both. And on behalf of the Cradle Roll, I would like to present you that gift and let you know that God loves you, I love you, and I look forward to seeing your baby real soon.
Amen, amen. Sister Giselle Fields from Deja.
Good morning and Happy New Year. Oh, what an awesome little man you have there. Hi there. On behalf of Decatur Adventist School, Decatur Adventist Junior Academy, we wanted to give to you a special gift. We know that Caden is a gift from God, and as Hannah toiled with God because she wanted that baby so desperately, she also understood that it was important to return him back to God. We are admonished to train up our children in the way they should go, because when they're older, they won't depart from it. He will be with them. So we have a special gift for you. Not only do we have a gift in the bag for you, but we also have a gift certificate for when Caden is ready to enter kindergarten. He has a gift certificate that will go toward his first tuition. So we are looking forward to having him be a part of the Deja family, which he already is. And we just want to say thank you, and we praise God for little Caden.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Mrs. Fields. And then from our elders.
These to him. This is a head start. As a marathoner, I've run marathons for many years, and I always look forward to a head start. Never got it. Anyway, this is a head start for him, that he can start to learn about God, learn about Jesus. And so we ask you to read these to him. So when he's of age, he'd be able to read it for himself, but he would get a head start as you read it to him. So, on behalf of the elders, please enjoy it.
Amen, amen, amen. Then, thank you, Elder Fredericks. And then, this is your dedication certificate. You want to keep that in a safe place. It is a legal document. Again, God bless you all. Also standing here, we have our women's ministries leader, our family life leaders are here. We just want you guys to know that we love you and that you are family. And we welcome you today. Again, God bless you. All right. Amen. Help him out.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, Decatur. Good morning and happy Sabbath, Decatur, and happy New Year. The Lord has brought us through 2022, and we are now in 2023. Amen. So turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor one thing that the Lord did for you last year. Turn to your other neighbor and tell that neighbor what the Lord did for you last year. Something to praise God for, amen?
Amen.
He brought us through another year, and I'm just so grateful to God for what he's done and what he's going to do. I'll share my personal testimony. I got approved for an apartment. I'm going to be closer to work, and I'm just so grateful to God that he answers prayers and that he'll see us through. And so we're going to give him a praise this morning, amen? I won't force you, but I invite you to stand. I invite you to worship. I invite you to clap, because God is just so good. He's been too good. He's been so good. Amen. So I invite you to worship with us this morning.
Are
our God, and all will see how great is our God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, our God is so great, and he's so mighty, and he's so loving, and he's so kind. And so we just say, because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. And I will lift my voice and sing. Hallelujah.
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you. Because of who you are, Lord,
for us. We worship you. You know, they asked, Pastor asked, so lean to one side, tell them what's new in 2023. There's this coin that I was speaking to one of my neighbors saying that more free in 2023. And you could apply that to anything you want, free from whatever you want that to apply to, but we're more freer in 2023. This assignment was providential. I wasn't scheduled today, but my fellow elder called me that he had to do something this Sabbath and asked if I would take his place. I said, sure. Not knowing that the Holy Spirit had been working through this past week, my friend Lenina came into town Tuesday and Wednesday. You know, Lenina is a storm. I don't know what y'all experienced Tuesday and Wednesday, but there at my house, it was like cannons were going off. The rain was coming down. And I think it was Tuesday night, I had to drive home, and I couldn't take the highway. I had to take the local roads. And I'm driving the local road. You know, I coin myself on being a great driver. That night, I could not see 2 feet in front of me. The rain was coming so hard, the wind was blowing, and the only thing that guided me was the yellow line on this side and the white line on this side. I didn't know what was on the right side, and I only knew something was on my left side when I see the light coming towards me. I said, Father, no, this song that Michaela told me a long time ago that I listened to and I coined it, Angela Benestelli called, Lord, Take the Wheel. I couldn't drive. And you know, I'm always driving about, I can admit to it, not the speed limit. I just say not the speed limit. I don't know how much above it, but not the speed limit. That night, I think I was driving 5 to 10 miles an hour. And that's how slow I had to go. Because, and I'm thinking, why? He has an assignment for me. And you know, from all that I've done, he's like, he could have let me just go there, but he had an assignment for me. I didn't know what the assignment was. I prayed for Tuesday night. I prayed for Wednesday night prayer service. I said that wasn't the assignment. Then when the elder Legall called and said, ask me to exchange, I said, Lord, that's the assignment. You wanted me to stand in front of your kids and tell them how your children tell you how good you are to us. Even from all that we've done, you still love us to keep us. Last night I was speaking to another brother that we're in this group, my support group. And we were I said, I need to coin a name for our group because we don't have a name. He said, let's call it the Jamaican Support Group. There's about 6 of us, but 4 of us are Jamaicans. The others are West Indian, and one American that we adopted to be West Indian. He's going to be a Jamaican, but I said, let's call it the Jamaican Support Group. He said, that's a good one, Lud. But then he called me back an hour later. He said, no, don't use that one. He said, what have God done for all of us? And then afterwards, he said, he gave us all second chances. I say, you're absolutely right. Some more than others. I've gotten so many second chances, I don't know if I'm deserving, but he have done so many second chances for me. And if God had given y'all, anyone, second chances and want to join me here at the front, come and do so now so we can thank him for all the second chances he has given us. So I'll wait till you come. I'll read this until y'all come. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes it boast in the Lord. Let me humble here and be glad. Oh, magnifying the Lord with me. And let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and those who and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and delivers them from taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer and want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. There's allergies in here and making it just rain here, but let us just seek the Lord in prayer. Father, we, your children, come to you to just lift your name on high, to thank you for all the second chances you have given us. We ask that you look within us, see what's not like you, and remove it, Father, we pray, so that these words will not stay below the ceiling, but lift up to your throne room, where your Son intercedes on our behalf, and you can bless us through him, according to your loving kindness, his loving kindness, because ours are his filthy rags, Father. We thank you for this first blessed Sabbath of the new year of 2023, where we are more free to do your will. Father, we thank you for just bringing us here to worship you. Those who are coming, we ask that you bring them safely. Father, we ask that you'll just tarry with us through this whole Sabbath experience that we're going to experience today. We thank you for your mercy. We're praying for the following individuals: James Hackett, Eric Donwell, Mary Felder, Richard Streeter, Shirley Melton, the Pridgen family, Elder Richard Kay, Elder Rod Thomas, Jordan and Victoria Ruff, Thomas Collins, Felicia Stewart and Cameron Wallace, Bernice Johnson and family, Terry Barnett and family, Gary Presley, my wife. And we also pray for my group, who new named my Second Chances support group. Father, we also pray for the bereaved. You spoke to us and you asked us to go on the mission, Jeremy Watkins and myself. You asked us to anoint this young man, Eustace Nicholas. Father, he is so strong in your love that we went there and he was testifying that he's going to do your will. We did not know if it was going to be on this earth now or on the earth made new, but he was strong in the faith to know that he was going to do your will, and you allowed us to anoint him. And he also took part in your communion on Sabbath. Lord, you prepared him, and you used us to help prepare him for your will. Bless his family. Be with Carol in a special way. We ask that you be with the Fuoli family. We'll be with Madeline as she lost her aunt. Be with our dear brother, Todd, who lost his dad so quickly. We ask that you'll just lift him up there, Father, in a special way. And Father, we just want to say thank you for all that you have done. Undeserving we are, but still yet you bless us. We ask that you be with the Speaker of the Hour, be with Pastor Ross. Use him in a mighty way to let us hear what you have to say to us. And Lord, when you shall come, take us all home with thee, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
in total adoration unto you. You reign on the throne, for you are God and God alone. Because of you, my cloudy days are gone. I can sing to you this song. I just want to say that I love you more than anything. Everybody say, I lift
my hands in total adoration to you.
You reign on the throne, for you are God.
For you are God.
story ends. For in 3 days, he rose again. That's love. That's love.
Put your hands together. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I want to thank you, Natalia, and our praise team, all of our musicians who've ministered earlier, who minister today and each and every Sabbath. We truly praise God for you all. And just in case for those who may not know that earlier in the prayer segment, we're lifting up Todd Windham and his family, and that Todd is our drummer, lost his dad. And we just want you to know, Todd, when one grieves, we all grieve. And so our prayers are with you. Right after services today, he's heading out to New York to attend the funeral. And we just appreciate your presence and your ministry so much. And we know that, God, a better day is coming. We want to pause in our service right now to acknowledge all of our educators, in particular those who minister at the Decatur Adventist Junior Academy, Deja, and our Early Learning Center. And I'm going to invite them to come because Christian education is very, very critical, especially at a time like this. Ellen White wrote many years ago that the work of education and the work of redemption are one. Did you hear that? The work of education and the work of redemption are one. And so the work of our educators is just as important as what happens here in this pulpit. They're preparing our children not just for this life, but for the life to come. And so I want to call on all of our educators, if you would join us down front. We can invite the principal, Ms. Giselle Fields for Deja, our school board chair, Elder Iris A. Miles. She's already here, amen. And we are also going to invite the staff from the Early Learning Center. We have our new board chair, Sister Elena Bell. Elena, where are you? Yeah, and our director, come on. Yeah, as a matter of fact, why don't you come on up? There's our director, Mrs. Precious Fuller, and all of the staff. We invite you to come. All of our educators, we want you to come on up. We want this community to see you, recognize you, and also to affirm you in what you do. And to, yes, substitute teachers, if we have any subs here today. Amen, amen, amen. You're a part of the team. Put your hands together for him and for them as they come. Amen, amen. We praise God for you. Our elders are going to anoint you. Right now, they're going to lay hands on you. They're going to anoint you all in the Lord. They have oil. They're going to put some oil on you. Amen. That oil that represents the Holy Spirit. We want to consecrate you today for this year because we know that you all have battles to fight, not just in the classroom with the enemy, but you got your personal issues and struggles and things that you're dealing with. So we want to pray for you. And then after we're done praying, we're going to call on Dr. Nathaniel Higgs, a veteran educator, retired. Retired but not tired, amen? We're going to have him to come and pray for all of us as we move into this year. So we're going to ask you all in the congregation, if you would just bow your heads and pray, lift up Deja, lift up our educators, as the elders pray as well. Elders, would you all just pray for each of these here today?
Thank you. our God and our Father. This morning we are grateful to be in your presence at this service of anointing of your loved ones, of your people. Standing behind me this morning are board members, teachers, administrators, support staff, early learning daycare workers, pastors, ministers, educators, and many supporters. And today, we're asking for an anointment of your Holy Spirit upon each of your workers. We are, as it were, the host of the Lord. So this morning, first of all, we pray that you would cleanse us of all of our unrighteousness. We would not want it said that there is any one sin that would stand as a petition between the throne room and this podium. And so we ask for cleansing. We would not want you to turn your face from us, but to hear our prayers. We ask for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lord, there's one that's missing. And that is Sister Felicia Stewart. She was on her way going to take care of your business. The devil tried to snap her life out, head-on collision. But thank you, Jesus, that you overruled in that situation. Yes, you were with her through many operations in the hospital. And you've seen her through, but today she is convalescing at home, perhaps even watching this service via the internet. But we ask that you would continue to bless her, to bring healing to her body, restore her back to her full normality, and may she go back into the classroom to continue her work as a mighty worker, a mighty teacher, an instructor of righteousness. Then, Lord, we vary in our needs as we vary in our looks. We ask that your Holy Spirit would come now and fall upon us afresh like falling dew. We ask that you'd give us the wisdom of Solomon, that he might be able to walk in your footsteps, each walk in your footsteps. We ask, Lord, that you'd give us the meekness of Moses, that one day each would be able to walk in Jerusalem just like John, inherit the kingdom of God. We ask that you would give us the forbearance of Paul, who said he had fought a good fight and finished the course. We ask, Lord, that you'd give each one the patience of Job, who trust and faith was so strong that it could not be corroded by any of the outside external influences. We ask, Lord, that you'd give us the love of Jesus, who said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. When they stand in their classrooms, when they stand in the cradle room, we pray, Lord, that when they're faced with challenges, that they would seek your wisdom first, because your solution is always the right solution. When they stand faced with institutional financial shortcomings, we ask, Lord, that they would remember that they must go forth in faith, that the silver and gold is yours, that the cattle upon a thousand hills are yours, that the earth is yours and the fullness thereof, and that we are your stewards, that we only manage your goods. And while we cannot take it with us, we certainly can send it on ahead. So, Lord, we pray now that your Holy Spirit would fall upon each one on this stage, that we may do your will. When at last our work is over, may it be written that you have done well in our lives. We pray, Lord, for the parents of the students that attend the Early Learning Daycare Center and Deja. We're just so grateful that you have allowed these institutions to be so instrumental in our congregation and in the community, that we have had individuals that have been leaders in our community as well as within the church. Lord, we're just grateful for them. So bless us to this end. We'll be grateful, give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in the precious and beautiful and salvific name of Jesus. Let everyone say, amen.
And we say amen? Amen, amen. You may return to your seats. Let's continue to lift up these two institutions in our prayers. Remember them each and every day.
This morning, I'll present a song to you simply by the title, The Give Me Jesus.
When I come to die,
Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world. You can have all this world. You can have all this world, but give me
Brother Hines. Can we say amen again, everybody? Give me Jesus. That's so fitting for this brand new year. It's good to see each and everybody here today. Those of you who are here in person, those of you who are online, we praise God for your presence today. If you've been blessed, let me hear you just say, I've been blessed. Amen, amen. I'm going to invite you to take your devices in hand. If you would stand with me right about now as we turn to the book of Mark, chapter 4. We're going to go to Mark, chapter 4, verses 35 through 41 will be our scripture for meditation today. Again, Mark, chapter 4, beginning at verse 35. We're going to be going to the English Standard Version, and I will read in your hearing. Here's what the Word of God says. It says, on that day when evening had come, he said to them, let us go across to the other side. And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was, and other little boats were with him. And the Bible says a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling up. But he was in the stern, asleep on a cushion. And they awakened him and said to him, Teacher, do you not even care that we are perishing? And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? This afternoon, we want to focus your attention on verses 35 and 36. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, let us go to the other side. I want to talk to you about the other side. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time to go to the other side. Father God, bless us now as we wait in your presence. We thank you for what you've already done and for what you're about to do in Jesus' name. Let everybody say, amen and amen. You may be seated in his presence today. The other side. Jesus is calling us to go this year in 23 to the other side. We have announced our theme for this year as a new level. Somebody say a new level. Now, when we were coming up with this theme, somebody said to me, Pastor, I like a next level. I think that's even a little better. And I said, well, why? They said, the next level is gentler. It's not so scary. I said, really? And they said, yeah, you know, next level just sounds like we're going to the next level. But a new level, that sounds radical. It just sounds so new and scary. And I said, I get it. And that is exactly what Jesus is calling us to. He's calling us to somewhere we have never been before. Can you say amen? He's calling us this year to do something we've never done before, to experience something we have never experienced before, and that requires a new level of trust and faith and confidence in him. When Jesus said, let us go to the other side, It was not a suggestion. It was a command. When Jesus said, let's go to the other side, it was not a suggestion, church. It was a command. Now, I can imagine somebody could have said, well, Jesus, where are we going? The other side. Well, Jesus, what's on the other side? Let's go and see. Let's go to the other side. In other words, I got a plan for you, and you've got to trust me. So you either get on board or you get left behind. Let's go. The question is today, church family, are you ready to go? It wasn't a trick question. It wasn't a rhetorical question. So I'm going to ask it again. Decatur church family, are you ready to go? Are you ready to go with Jesus to the other side, to a whole new level? Now, let me say this real quick before I go on, because I want to keep it real this afternoon. New levels mean new devils. New levels mean new devils. New levels bring new challenges, new problems, new mountains, new storms. And so as we prepare for this journey in 2023, as we prepare to go to the other side, there are three questions we need to ask ourselves. There are three questions that we all must deal with today as we prepare for a new level going to the other side in 2023. You might want to get out some recording device because I'm going to do some teaching this afternoon. Is that all right? Beginning of this new year. Three questions if we're going to go to a new level. The first question is, what will I forsake? What will I forsake in this year? The Bible says in verse 36, leaving the crowd behind. Did you get it? Leaving the crowd behind. They took him along as he was in the boat. The question is, what do you need to leave behind in order to grow spiritually? You cannot go anywhere unless you're prepared to leave something behind. It is inherent in the journey. Come on, say amen. If you're trying to go out east to New York, you're going to have Georgia in your rearview mirror. Am I making sense today? So, as we deal with this thing spiritually, do you have some sin issue or issues that you just need to leave behind? Or you've been dabbling with that thing all last year. You've been dabbling with it long enough. You've been going to the edge and even putting your finger in it. Or maybe you just plain fell right into it, and now you are wrapped up and tied up in it. Can I offer you some hope this afternoon? The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 13 that whosoever conceals his transgressions will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy. Come on, say amen. So not only must we come to God and confess that stuff, but we've also got to turn away from it. Somebody say, turn away. In other words, don't drive down her street no more. Cancel the subscription. Oh, I got to go on. There's some things that we all have to leave behind. There's some things that we need to forsake this year if we're going to go to the other side with Jesus. Come on, say amen. But not only do we have sin issues, but what about our schedules? What about our schedule this year? Is Jesus a priority? If you go over your schedule, your plans for this year, your plans for each month, each week, each day, is Jesus a priority? Is Jesus number one? Does your schedule, does the way you occupy your time reveal that he is number one? Are there some things that you need to delete out of your schedule this year? Some things that you just got to let go of. They might not be bad things in and of themselves, but they've come to occupy a place on your schedule that perhaps should only belong to Jesus. I got to let it go. Somebody said, let it go. It might not be a sin issue. It might not be your schedule, but it might be a certain somebody, a certain someone. Are y'all with me today? And that certain somebody may be good to you, but they're not good for you. And you know it because you're not walking in the same direction. It's a physical thing. It may even be an emotional thing, but you're not connected where it matters the most, and that's spiritually. Am I talking to anybody today? Jesus said in Matthew 16, 24, he said to his disciples, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Come on, say amen. You see, following Jesus always costs us something. When Jesus said to Matthew, follow me, he left a lucrative job with the Roman IRS. When Jesus said to Luke, follow me, he left his medical practice to follow Jesus. When Jesus said to the woman at the well, follow me, she left her water pot behind her. What I'm trying to say is that it costs to follow Jesus. You've got to be willing to leave some things behind. When Jesus said to Peter, James, and John, follow me, they had just struck it big. They had caught the largest catch of fishes in their lives. Are you willing, church family? Are you willing, my brothers and sisters, to make the sacrifice? Matthew, the woman at the well, Peter, James, and John discovered that it was worth it. Which leads me to my next question that you and I must confront. I'm not going to be long today. If we're going to go to the other side, we must first of all decide and answer the question, what am I willing to forsake? What am I willing to leave behind? What am I willing to let go for the journey that I must take with Jesus in this year? The next question that we must all deal with, the next question we must answer is, what will I take? What will I forsake? And secondly, what will I take? In verse 36 again, the Bible says, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. See, when you decide, church, to follow Jesus, you're making a commitment to take him with you just the way he is and nothing else. When you decide to follow Jesus, you are making a commitment to take him just the way he is and nothing else. You see, here's where we struggle, because we discover along our Christian journey that Jesus is not all that we thought he would be. You see, we want Jesus along with us so long as he fits within our understanding of what he should be. We want a Jesus who is comfortable with my sin, but not your sin. We want a Jesus who loves people who love us back. We want a Jesus who will get those who make life hard for us. We want a Jesus who answers all of our prayers when we want him to, how we want him to, in the way we want him to. But can I tell you that if you're going to take Jesus with you in 2023, you got to take him just as he is. Bible says they took him just as he was. Well, how was he? He was absolutely tired. He was absolutely wore out on that ship, so much so that he fell soundly asleep. But they discovered in that sleeping Jesus, the sovereign God of the universe. That means that even while he may be sleeping in your situation, he's still in control. Just watch this for a minute. The Bible says that as they were traveling on the other side with Jesus asleep in the ship, that there arose a great storm. Can I say something here? There are going to be some storms in 2023. And I'm not talking about physical storms, though there are going to be those, but I'm talking about some emotional storms, some relational storms, some mental storms, some financial storms. Just because Jesus is in the ship with you, just because Jesus loves you, just because Jesus gave you the command to get going doesn't mean that you're not going to have to face some storms. Mighty quiet in the house. I'm just trying to prepare you. The Bible says, Jesus told them, let's cross over. And then it says that there arose a great storm. Watch this now. Not just any kind of storm, but the Bible says in verse 37, a great storm. They called out to Jesus in their despair. They thought this was it. They were about to go under. And then they awakened him, and he got up, and you know what he did? He spoke to the winds and the waves, and he said, hush up, and watch this now. The Bible says that there was a great calm. Oh, you missed it. You missed it. In verse 37, it says there was a great storm. And then in verse 39, it says, when Jesus had spoken to the winds and the waves, that there was a great calm. You see, what Jesus was trying to tell them is, I'm sovereign. There's no one or nothing greater than me. You can take him with you and trust him wherever you go, no matter what the storm is that you're going to have to face, no matter how great the problem. For the greater your problem, the greater his solution. The greater your need, the greater his supply. The greater your sorrow, the greater is his comfort. The greater your loss, the greater his returns. The greater your setback, the greater his comeback. The greater your storm, the greater is his calm and the peace that he gives. Somebody ought to shout amen. So if you take him as he is, you got to learn to trust him as he is. See, Jesus is not about your comfort. He's about your character. Jesus is not about your comfort. He's about your character. Jesus is the God who hates sin but loves the sinner. He will answer all your prayers in his own time and in his own way and always for what's best for you. Come on, say amen. You got to ask the question, as we prepare to go to the other side in 2023, what will I forsake? What will I leave behind? What will I take? And the third and final question is, what impact will I make? What impact will I make this year? The Bible says back again in verse 36, that leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. And then it goes on to say that there were also other boats with him. They left the crowds behind. They left the people behind. But there were some folk who decided, look, wherever Jesus is going, and wherever these disciples are going, I'm going too. The disciples were obedient, and the Bible says that other boats followed them. You see, when you decide to follow Jesus, you become an influencer for the kingdom of God. See, people today call influencers, and they get paid big money to use their platform to influence folk to do something. An influencer is somebody who's able to get other people to follow them. The moment you decide to follow Jesus, you become an influencer. Somebody ought to say amen out there. See, the moment you start following Jesus, people start watching you. Are y'all with me today? They're watching you, and there are three main areas they're going to be watching you, or four rather. The first thing they're watching you is to see is their passion. Do you have a passion for Jesus? The psalmist David said that as the deer pants after the water brooks, so pants my soul after God. How are you serving him? How are you coming to him? Are you half-stepping or are you running after him? Are you chasing after him? There are folk watching your passion, your energy. Secondly, they're watching how you follow him in pain. They're watching how you follow him during those difficult times in life when you have to deal, when you've got to go through stuff. At a funeral recently, there's a text that was read that we often read at most of our funerals, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13, where the Apostle Paul says, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant concerning those who are asleep, that you grieve not as those who have no hope. And it's a wonderful passage. It's one that we love very much and for good reason. But I realize that as we have read this text, I think we read it a little too quickly. And sometimes we get the understanding that as a child of God, we're not supposed to grieve. And so maybe instead of reading the text so quickly, we need to stop for a minute. Because the text says that you grieve. Let's stop right there. We all are going to grieve. Amen? In this life, there's going to be some pain. We're going to experience some loss. And it's okay to grieve. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that Jesus wept when he came upon the grave of one of his best friends named Lazarus. And when the Bible says Jesus wept, it wasn't just shedding a tear here and there. No, he was boo-hooing. I mean, his shoulders were shuddering. Jesus wept, the Bible says. There are times we're going to experience grief, but here's what the text says. We grieve not as those who have no hope. If you know the mama loved Jesus, if you know the mama loved Jesus, you know that a better day is coming. You know that he that shall come will come, and he shall not keep silence. If mama loved Jesus, you know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. If daddy loved Jesus, you know that it's not goodbye, but see you later. Amen? And that will impact how you go through that grief. Folk are watching you. They're watching you in terms of your passion. They're watching you in your pain. They're watching you in your problems. In this world, Jesus says, you're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. In other words, don't focus on the problems. Focus on the problem solver. Because folk are watching how you go through your stuff. Finally, they're watching how you deal with persecution. How you deal with persecution. When folk are messing with you, when folk are even trying to take you out, to make you look bad, to just destroy your reputation. The Bible lets us know in the book of Acts chapter 7 and verse 60, it says that then he fell on his knees. This is Stephen, the first Christian martyr. He fell on his knees and cried out while they're stoning him, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Can y'all believe that? When the Bible says he had said this, he fell asleep or he died. And then in chapter 8 and verse 1 it says, and Saul was there giving approval, signing off on the death of Stephen. It was the same Saul who would become Paul the apostle. How Stephen died, not just how Stephen lived, but how Stephen died, convicted Paul that Stephen was the real deal. Convicted Paul that Jesus was the real deal. Convicted Paul that the gospel was real. You see, you might be Stephen this year. Keep in mind, Stephen, when those rocks are hitting you, there's a Saul waiting to become a Paul who's watching how you handle persecution, how you conduct yourself when everything is against you. You are an influencer. You can make an impact wherever you are, whoever you are. You don't have to have a degree. You don't have to have a lot of money. You don't have to know a lot of important people. You don't have to be popular. You don't have to have 100,000 followers on Facebook or Twitter or some other platform. All you got to do is faithfully follow Jesus. People are looking, and the world needs something that is real. You are what they're looking for. Well, as they come to play, my pianists, my musicians, will you decide? The question is today. To go to the other side with Jesus. Are you willing to forsake, to take, and to make an impact? To go to a whole new level in 2023. What am I talking about? Talking about a new level in your walk with God. A new level in your prayer life. A new level in your worship. A new level in your giving. A new level in your praise. A new level in your personal growth and your professional development. A new level in your mental health and your self-care. A new level in your relationships. A new level in your ministry. A new level in your commitments. A new level in your physical well-being. I'm ready for a new me in 23. What about you today? Every head is bowed, and every eye is closed. is you got to answer in your own heart these three questions. What am I willing to forsake? What am I willing to leave behind this year so I can go with Jesus? And as I go, am I willing to take him just as he is, the sovereign God, to surrender myself completely to his direction, to his nudging, to his promptings, to his guidance? What kind of an impact will I make this year, influencing others for the kingdom of God? In your mind, you know what it is you need to leave behind. You know what might be standing between you and Jesus. And you're saying right now, you're praying right now with me, Lord, I'm giving that thing to you right now. Whatever that issue is, whatever that sin issue is, whatever that somebody is, whatever that scheduling issue is, God, I'm just turning it over to you right now. I'm giving it to you right now, Lord. And wherever you lead, I'm going to follow, Lord. I'm giving you full control of my life right now. You're praying, you're praying. You're online and you're praying right now. You're asking God in this quiet moment to take full control. Jesus, have your way. And I know if you do, Lord, I'm going to make the impact that you've ordained for me to make in 2023. To be a whole new me, to be free in 2023. That's your desire. And you, on this first Sabbath of a brand new year, you're watching us online, you're here in the presence, and you're saying, Pastor, you're saying, brothers and sisters, I want to go to a new level this year, personally, with my church family, with my family. If that's your desire, I'm going to invite you to stand. Even as you are in your living room, in your bedroom, wherever you are, I'm going to invite you to stand as well with us right now. You're saying, I'm going to a new level this year. I've heard the message. I've heard the call from Jesus. Let's go to the other side. I don't know all of what that looks like, but I know that anywhere with Jesus, I can safely go. I don't need to know all that's going to happen, how I'm going to get through it. I just need to know him, because he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He's all that you need, and you're going to be okay as you trust him with your ship, with your vessel. My second appeal right now is, somebody today has not yet made that decision for Jesus. Or maybe you made it and you fell away along the way, and you're saying, this year I want to start over. This year I want to recommit. This year I'm coming back to Jesus. I'm coming back to the family of God. This year I'm starting it out right. I want to give you an opportunity right now. Don't let this moment pass you by. Just step out of your seat and join me down front. You're saying yes to Jesus. God bless you, my brother. Put your hands together for him. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Somebody else saying yes. Come on down. Come on down. Saying yes to Jesus Christ. I call you in the name of Jesus. Slip out of your seat and come. This is your moment. This is your moment. You did not come into this house by chance. Not just because it's the first Sabbath of the year. No, 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 no. Jesus brought you here. The Holy Spirit led you here. Don't let this moment pass you by. You need to come, and you need to do it now. Slip out of your seat and come. You don't have tomorrow. All you have is today. While the blood runs warm in your body, warm through your veins, I call you in the name of Jesus. Slip out of your seat and come. He's calling you to a journey. It's a journey of transformation. You can't stay the same with Jesus. He never leaves anybody the same. Wouldn't you come? Wouldn't you open your heart? Somebody else, you need to come. You need to come. I call you in the name of Jesus. It's not about joining a church. It's about beginning a journey. It's about connecting with a Savior. It's about connecting with your Creator, the one who created you, the one who died for you. Turn it over to him. Do it now. Don't hesitate. Don't deliberate. Somebody else, you need to come. You're in the balcony, you're under the balcony. I'm waiting on you. I am waiting on you. Don't let anything or anybody keep you from doing the best thing you could ever do, the greatest decision you could ever make, to surrender your heart to Jesus Christ. Church, you're praying because something is telling me in my spirit that somebody else needs to come. I don't know you, sir. I don't know you, ma'am. But God does. He knows you. And he brought you here for this very moment. Don't let it pass you by. This is your time. The doors of the church, the doors of the kingdom of God are open to you. Come now. This is your best day, and this can be your best year. You're online. Go ahead and type the word decision to 619 Decatur. That's 619-332-2887. I'm about to pray now, about to have a closing prayer, but I'm keeping the door open. God is saying, Compton, keep the door open. Just a few more seconds. I'm waiting for you. No. Jesus is waiting for you. Come. Come right now. Pastor Adams, where's my assistant pastor? Or he may have slipped out. Elder Williams, would you come? I want you to come and pray for us. Pray for this young brother who responded to this appeal today. Pray for the people of God who are standing and those who are standing online. Pray for them right now.
We're here because of the blood of Jesus. We're here because he died on Calvary's cross for our sins. And Lord, he offers us the gift of eternal life. And so, Lord, we want to thank you so much for this young man who has decided to accept this free gift. And Lord, we have learned that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. And so, Lord, we just want to thank you that you have made him new by the decision that he has made today. And so, Lord, as he begins his walk with you, Lord, we ask that you will take him from glory to glory. Be with all of us in the audience who have decided that we want to go to a new level with you this year. Lord, we ask that you will help us to lean on your everlasting arms because we can do nothing without you. And Lord, as we put our arms in yours, as we put our trust in you, Lord, we'll ask that you will just take us to where you would have us to be. Lord, continue to bless the Decatur Seventh-day Adventist Church. May we fulfill the purpose that you have placed us here in the kingdom to fulfill. And Lord, when it's all said and done, we're going to give you all the praise, the honor, and glory because we ask it all and receive it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated in his presence today. Can somebody say amen? Can somebody say praise the Lord? Amen, amen. You will notice that we've made some changes in this year, 23, as we continue on our journey with Jesus. We want to thank you online for joining us today. We know you could click somewhere else, but you have remained with us, and we thank God for you today. We do want to share some announcements with you just before we close out our service today. If you would like to begin your journey with Jesus, we want to remind you that you can type the word decision to 619 Decatur. If you wish to simply become a member, you're here, present, or you're online, you want to connect with us, just type the word member to 619 Decatur. Today, we want to let you know, church family, that we're having lunch. It's going to be potluck over at the Crest Center. Somebody say amen. I believe it was last Sabbath we had our first lunch over there, and it was wonderful. Somebody say amen. And we've got space for everybody and food for everyone. And this is going to be sponsored. This potluck is being coordinated by our AYS, or Adventist Youth Society, now led by Sister LaTanya and Sister Destiny Carter. Somebody say amen. Amen, amen. We're here to support them and to support our young people. And we're looking forward to a phenomenal year. Amen? So immediately after the lunch today, at 4 o'clock p.m., they will have something for our young people, and we're all invited to come. Amen? And support and participate and just have a good time learning and growing together. Also, on this coming Wednesday, the 11th, we begin our 10 days of prayer and fasting. And we do want to encourage everybody to participate. When we're talking about going with Jesus, we need to be refueled and refilled. Come on, say amen. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we're inviting you. You're watching us online. Join us by setting aside January the 11th through the 21st. The theme is back to the altar. Amen? Back to the altar. And so this coming Wednesday, as we begin our 10 days at 7 o'clock p.m., we invite you to join with us by Zoom. The information has been sent out. It's also on our website. On the 21st of January, we will bring these 10 days to an end, and it's going to be a wonderful celebration as we celebrate the miracles of what we expect God to do during those 10 days. Also on the 21st, we want you to know that we will be resuming in-person Sabbath school for our adults. Today, our children and our young people were over in the Crest Center. Come on, say amen. Amen, amen. They're having a wonderful time. And so on the 21st, you know, for us grown folk, it takes a little more time to turn the ship. And so on the 21st, we're going to be over there with them as well for Sabbath school. And it's going to begin at 10:15. What time did I say, everybody? 10:15 a.m. Please note the slight adjustments in our services. On the 21st, our Sabbath school will begin at 10:15 a.m. We will still have an online component, so it will be hybrid. It will continue online, but we will also have something right here on the campus. Again, our regular worship services begin now at 11:50 a.m. What time did I say, everybody? 11:50 a.m. Amen. This Monday, January the 9th, our area commissioner, Larry Johnson, will be inaugurated for his sixth term. And I mention this because he is a supporter. He's a friend of Decatur's. Come on, say amen. And we support him in what he's trying to do. And his inauguration will be at 5:30 p.m. at the Porter Sanford Performing Arts and Community Center. That's right here in Decatur. So if you feel, please go on out and give him your support. We do have a couple of Sabbath birthdays, and we want to just give them a shout out today. Lakeisha Howard and Carol McLean. At the count of three, can we wish them happy Sabbath birthday? 2, 3. Happy Sabbath birthday. Lakeisha and Carol, God bless you. We love you. Let's give them a call, give them a text, and just let them know you love them in Jesus' name. I'm wondering today, are there any first-time guests today? Any individuals visiting us for the first time, would you stand? Would you stand? We want to recognize you. Would you stand? Would you stand? Would you stand? Let's put our hands together. Amen. We praise God for you. Good to have you. Looking for a church home? You found it. Can y'all say amen, church family? Amen. Amen. Glad to have you this morning. God bless you. We're going to turn it over to our elders at this time.
Amen. Decatur Church family, were you blessed today? Were you blessed today, Decatur Church family? Yes? Amen. Amen. I'm Elder Watkins. I'm going to give you your final instructions for today. And I just wanted to thank you all for coming out today. Your presence is very important to us, but your service is also important to God. And at this time, we want to thank you, and we hope that we also see you next Sabbath at 11:50 a.m. 11:50. If you're in the sanctuary at this time, we want to let you know, as you see the deacons here to your right, to my left, that they're going to be coming around during the praise team postlude to accept your tithes and offerings today. Also, if you're online, we'd like to let you know that there are three ways that you can give. First of all, you can give online by visiting us at our website. That's www.decatursdachurch.org/give. Once again, that's www.decatursdachurch.org/give. The second way is you can also give via Cash App using the handle $DSDAGive. Or the third way is to send it by mail. We'll eventually get that, but you can send it by mail through the U.S. Postal Service to P.O. Box 372032, Decatur, Georgia, 30037. And so if you are here in the sanctuary, we'd like to invite you to remain seated as the deacons will be coming around to serve you, to collect your tithes and offerings and your gifts while the praise team gives their postlude. And at this time, I would like to invite you to stand with me for the prayer over the offering as well as for the benediction. Please stand with me at this time. Let's bow our heads. Gracious Lord, we thank you for this Sabbath, and we thank you for this service, this worship service that has been awesome. We thank you for the challenging word presented to us by our pastor. And at this time, Lord, as we prepare to receive the tithes, your tithes and offerings, we pray, Lord, a special blessing upon every one who has to contribute, and even, Lord, those who do not have. We pray a special blessing in 2023 over their finances so that they may have to contribute next time. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the gifts that are about to be given today, and we pray that they would be used to further your gospel in these last days. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us also remain standing at this time for our benediction. Glory be to him who can keep you from falling and bring you safe to his glorious presence, innocent and happy. To God, the only God, who saves us through Jesus Christ our Lord, be the glory, majesty, authority, and power which he had before time began, now and forever. Amen.
From every nation,
from
This morning, and that she's alert and